Good morning and welcome from our DeBakey's education studio at the DeBakey Heart and Vascular Center. I'm Dr. William Zoghbi, Chief of Cardiology here at Methodist Hospital, and welcome to our Grand Rounds. We would love this Grand Rounds to be interactive, and just from a housekeeping point of view, if you're joining us by the web, go to pollev.com, enter DeBakey and respond to the activity. And if you're joining by text, text DeBakey, D-E-B-A-K-E-Y, to 37607 and text in your message. Today is a very special Grand Rounds. It is the 29th William Winters Lectureship. Dr. Winters was a beloved cardiologist here, probably the father of cardiology at Houston Methodist and in the Houston area, and a mentor to so many and a leader in cardiology. And it is so befitting to have a most distinguished lecturer today, guest lecturer, who is legendary and who is considered to be the father of modern cardiology, Dr. Eugene Braunwald. Dr. Braunwald is the distinguished Hersey Professor of Medicine at Harvard School of Medicine and the founding chair of the Thrombolysis and Myocardial Infarction Study Group, the TIMI group, at the Brigham and Women's Hospital. He trained at New York University School of Medicine, and his medical house staff training was at Mount Sinai and Johns Hopkins. He served as chief of cardiology and as clinical director of the NHLBI, and then founding chair of medicine at the University of California in San Diego. He was chair of the Department of Medicine at the Brigham and Women's Hospital for nearly 25 years. Since 2003, he has devoted himself full-time to cardiology research. His research has spanned over two-thirds of a century and has been transformational in many areas of cardiovascular medicine. His early work focused on the control and assessment of ventricular function. He was the first to measure both left ventricular ejection fraction and DPDT in patients. His group described the first neurohumeral defect in human heart failure, defined the pathophysiology of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and demonstrated salvage of the ischemic myocardium that we take for granted nowadays. His group was also the first to show improved survival of such patients with ACE inhibition treatment. In 1984, Dr. Braunwald became the founding chair of the TIMI study group, which has thus far conducted 70 clinical trials involving 350,000 patients worldwide. The TIMI trial findings have impacted many practice guidelines and favorably affected many lives. Science Watch listed Dr. Braunwald as the most frequently cited author in cardiology with an H-index of 229. Dr. Braunwald served as an editor of Harrison's Principle of Internal Medicine for 12 editions and is the founding editor of Heart Disease, now in its 12th edition also. These two textbooks are the most influential in their respective fields. Dr. Braunwald has received numerous awards and honors, including the Distinguished Scientist Award of the American College of Cardiology, the American Heart Association, and the European Society of Cardiology. He has received the Kober Medal of the Association of American Physicians, as well as Lifetime Achievements Awards from the Heart Failure Society of America, the American Association of Thoracic Surgery, and the American College of Cardiology. The Nobel Prize winners in medicine voted Dr. Braunwald as the person who has contributed the most to cardiology in recent years. He was the first adult cardiologist elected to the National Academy of Sciences in the United States. What a pleasure and an honor to have Dr. Braunwald with us today to give the Winters Lecture. Dr. Braunwald, it's a pleasure to have you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zoghbi. It's an honor for me to be able to give this lecture. I think that Dr. Winters, as you've pointed out, was a major figure in in the United States and really international cardiology. I remember him warmly as the president of the American College of Cardiology. I remember his presidential address, which was very moving. And he instigated a number of projects and asked me to participate in them, and that was my honor. I also had the opportunity to get to know Dr. DeBakey, who for about 8 years, we both served on the advisory council to the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute for one term, 4 years in the 70s, and then again in the 80s. And it was amazing for me to see Dr. DeBakey wield power in a positive direction. He pushed very, very hard, very vigorously for support of the Institute. He had good connections in Congress and, of course, had a wide patient population in Washington, D.C., and he used that in a very, very fulsome and very positive manner. He was also extremely interested in education and in the fellowship programs that were started by the NHLBI. So it's really a double pleasure for me to be with you this morning. Now, I recorded this lecture that you're going to hear just a few days ago, and my reason and discussions with Dr. Zoghbi was that sometimes when you do these things live, unexpected things happen. And so this is a recorded lecture, but I will stay with it. And I hope toward the end, if you have any questions or commentary, perhaps you can send those to Dr. Zoghbi, and we can have a good discussion afterwards. So again, thank you so much for inviting me. This is a great honor for me. Thank you.
A pleasure and an honor to have you with us. And who best to talk about the future of cardiology than you, Dr. Braunwald? So we're looking forward to hearing it.
Well, welcome to Medical Grand Rounds. It is a pleasure for me to speak to this distinguished audience. I want to say something very important about Dr. Winters, William Winters, for whom this Grand Rounds is named. He was a brilliant cardiologist and a wonderful mentor and has made many contributions to the field of cardiology. And I would like to dedicate these Grand Rounds to Dr. Winters. So these are my disclosures. So in looking ahead, and the goal of this Grand Rounds is to give you some ideas about where I think cardiology is going during the next 10 years. So we're talking about a period from 2022 to 2032. And we're going to talk briefly about polygenic risk scores, primordial prevention, control of dyslipidemias, artificial intelligence, anti-inflammatory drugs, and clonal hematopoiesis. First, we begin with polygenic risk scores. Polygenic risk scores, many diseases are monogenic diseases. This is just a single gene that is responsible for the disease. But most conditions that we deal with in cardiology, for example, ischemic heart disease, coronary artery disease, hypertension, diabetes, all of these multiple genes. So they're polygenes. And risk scores are being developed. And I'll give you some examples of how they are developed. This is an early slide. It's about 3.5 years old. And it's the genomic risk score for patients with coronary artery disease. And you see these curves as age is on the horizontal axis and the risk of coronary artery disease is on the vertical axis. First curve, which is in green, is the highest risk group. And the highest risk group, you can see by the age of 70 years, they have a 30% incidence of coronary disease. And then at different levels of risk, it comes later and later. So the lowest risk group at the age of 70, only 10% have coronary disease. So this is a general approach. It doesn't help you very much with individual patients, although by having this information, you can certainly make decisions about diet and about whether somebody is at high risk of developing ischemic heart disease. You might want to concentrate more on the LDL cholesterol. But I think the direction that the field is taking from what you see on this slide, which is fairly primitive, is to combine information from a polygenic risk score with other information that we as clinicians gather. So I want to spend a couple of minutes on atrial fibrillation. All of us are acquainted with that. And we have known for a number of years that there are hereditary factors in the risk of developing atrial fibrillation. In the TIMI trials, we worked with four trials, a total of 36,000 patients with coronary artery disease, and who did not have a history of atrial fibrillation. And by doing a polygenic risk score, we were able to divide them into three groups. A high risk group shown in red, intermediate risk group in blue, and low risk group in green. And so you see about a doubling of risk at 1,000 days. Between the lowest and the highest risk group. So it gives you some information. But what it doesn't tell you is you have to take that information and also understand the clinical situation that the patient is in. So there are clinical risk factors. And let's say for atrial fibrillation, they would include certainly age is a very important one. I think the presence or absence of hypertension, of heart failure, all of these go into clinical risk factors. So if we have the genetic risk factor and the clinical risk factors, we can put them together. This provides much more information than those simple three Kaplan-Meier curves that you saw before. So you see nine rectangles. On your left, these red blocks, and they represent patients in the high genetic risk. The blue rectangular boxes are patients with the intermediate risk, and the green are the lower polygenic risk scores. Now, if you look across these, you find that the lowest clinical risk group then moving horizontally, you have the intermediate clinical risk group and highest is the high clinical risk group. So what we're combining is we're combining clinical information here with a polygenic risk score. And look what this allows us to do. Very simple clinical information. If you have a low genetic risk score, and a low clinical risk score, the risk of developing atrial fibrillation over a three-year period was only 1.4%. Now go all the way to the red and to the back, and you see the highest bar are patients at a high genetic risk score and a high clinical risk score. And you see that they have an 8.1%. So there's a six-fold difference in risk by simply taking very straightforward clinical observations that we all make every day and a polygenic risk score. Put those together and you get this very, very fine very precise risk. And you can go one step further. And we have known for a long time that an NT-proBNP biomarker, tells you a lot about the stress on the ventricle and therefore the stress on the atrium, is also a useful descriptor of risk. So now you have three things. We have clinical risk, we have the polygenic risk score, that's PRS, and we have an elevated NT-proBNP or not. So now we have nine possible combinations. And you see it's refined even further. You go between 1.3%, which is the low clinical risk and the low polygenic risk score, and a normal NT-proBNP, 1.3%, and that goes almost 15-fold to having all three of these abnormal. So the message that I want to leave you with is that polygenic risk scores are going to be very, very important risk markers, but they shouldn't be used alone. They should be integrated with the work that we do as physicians with chemical biomarkers, in this instance, the NT-proBNP, or very simple clinical measures like the patient's age, history of hypertension, diabetes, et cetera. And you can get an extremely accurate risk assessment. Now, how would we use that? Well, in patients with ischemic heart disease, patients come in and they are at the highest risk, 15.9%, over the course of a year. It would be about 30% over 2 years. These are the people that should be followed very, very closely for the development of AF, maybe with a loop recorder. But you wouldn't expend that kind of energy on a patient at a very low risk, like the patient at the left bottom of only 1.3%. So this kind of gradation is enormously helpful. And I think this is where genetics is going to play an ever more important role in clinical cardiology. Now to primordial prevention. Now, we all know about secondary prevention. Patient has coronary artery disease, may have had a myocardial infarction, and has a high LDL, and we want to try to prevent further damage, and we treat them with LDL lowering therapy. That's secondary prevention. Primary prevention, we all know, is a patient has a risk factor for coronary disease, let's say hypertension, but has had no clinical manifestations. Well, of course, you have to hit the hypertension.
primordial prevention goes back even further. It goes to prevent the initial development of risk factors. Patient has no risk factors, usually a child, and you go backwards. And here are a couple of examples of primordial prevention, which I believe is going to be of critical importance in the future. Here's a paper in the Journal of Clinical Hypertension, and it indicates that the childhood blood pressure, and the childhood blood pressure is we're talking about children before the age of five, childhood blood pressure tracks into adulthood. So although the child doesn't have hypertension, if it has higher blood pressures, blood pressure may be only under 100, but for the majority of children of that age, let's say the age of three, the blood pressure might be over less than 90, and a pressure of 100, which wouldn't be of any importance in an adult, is of importance in a child. And this tracks into adult life. So if you then, to primordially prevent is, you want to treat, you want to recognize the track that this child is on, because if you leave it alone, it will be associated with cardiac and vascular damage, left ventricular hypertrophy, and some carotid wall thickness, and perhaps even stroke. So we want to move back as far as we can in prevention. Another area is we think about moving back. Hypertension in the offspring can be an effect of the prenatal period, where the mother has diabetes or obesity, hypertension, that may be present in the infant as well. So the earlier we go, the better. So that's why prenatal care is extremely important, not just simply for the delivery, but for a healthy child that doesn't track with hypertension in the future. This can be carried out very early in life. It can actually be carried out in a newborn because the genes don't change during life. So if you discovered the presence of a pattern of genes, polygenes, that suggest that this patient is going to have a high cholesterol or suggest that the patient is going to be hypertensive, you can become aware of that at the time of birth. And I think that is, obviously, that may change the child's diet. It may change a number of what you look for and that what you would be alerted to. So here we go back into prevention, when I call it primordial prevention. We're going back to the primordial period as early as birth and sometimes even before birth. Now I'd like to spend a few minutes on the control of dyslipidemias. Obviously a very important subject to cardiologists and has been for 100 years and is going to continue to be so. Now, there's a drug called inclisiran that you may have heard of. It was approved by the FDA just about a month ago. It was approved in Europe about a year ago. So this is a small interfering RNA which blocks the production by the liver of a protein called PCSK9. And this protein changes the number of receptors. The presence of PCSK9 elevates the cholesterol. And I think, as many of you know, we now have very good monoclonal antibodies that block PCSK9, and they're very potent LDL lowering. That's the good news. In other words, they, in addition to statins, which we have worked with for 50 years, we have PCSK9 monoclonal antibodies, which are just as powerful as statins. And there's no reason that you can't use both. The problem with the monoclonal antibodies is that they have a short half-life. And therefore, if you want to block PCSK9, they require injections, either every 4 weeks or preferably even every 2 weeks. And that's not easy to accomplish. It's expensive. And there is a method, a new drug. It's a Novartis drug developed by a Cambridge company called Alnylam, blocks the hepatic production. It was found you give one or two injections a year, it reduces the LDL cholesterol in patients at high cardiovascular risk who have an elevated LDL cholesterol. And that's been shown in about a dozen trials, its effect over the course of a year. So the horizontal line at the top is placebo. So there was no change in the LDL. Then there are three colored lines, and just focus on the blue one. This is a dose ranging study, single injection. And you see that there is a drop within a month or two by about 50% in the LDL. And then it gradually returns in the normal direction. At the end of a year, it's down by 20%. So if you then repeat a second injection 1 year later, you see you're starting at a lower level, 20% lower level of LDL than before. Make a long story short, that if you give a single injection a year, one injection a year, you reduce the LDL by 40%. That's the area under the curve, by 40%. So that's a very remarkable change. Now I want to introduce you to a concept which is gaining a lot of prominence. And there are two ideas about atherogenesis. The first one is what we call the cumulative LDL cholesterol burden. So it's not only what is the LDL cholesterol level, but how long has it lasted? So you have a circulating LDL, and if it's something that has been elevated for a year, that's quite different from being elevated since birth. The second concept I want you to understand is the CHD, the coronary heart disease threshold. This is the age in years when the cumulative LDL burden reaches a level which causes clinical coronary heart disease. And the clinical coronary heart disease could be the first development of angina. It could be an MI. It could be a sudden cardiac death. It could be any of these things, but it means a clinical expression. So these are the two things I want you to remember, the cumulative burden and the threshold. So this is a hypothetical person who has an LDL of 100 milligrams per deciliter. That's the green line. And you see that burden is gradually increasing as this patient ages. Age in years is on the horizontal axis. Then you see the broken line, horizontal line in red, that's the threshold. So when the green line, which is the cumulative burden, hits that threshold, is on average when that patient will develop the first manifestations of coronary heart disease. And in this instance, it's at the age of 70 years. Now, if you have a patient with a heterozygous familial hypercholesterolemia, which is a monogenic disease in the LDL receptor, you can see patient as is born with an LDL of 200 and remains at 200, and you see accumulates the burden much more rapidly. And so the red line crosses the threshold at the age of 35. And that might be the average age in which a patient with familial heterozygous hypercholesterolemia would develop their first myocardial infarction. Very rare is homozygous hypercholesterolemia. Fortunately, it's a pretty uncommon condition, probably less than a million patients in the United States. They have no LDL receptors at all, and therefore their LDL cholesterol is extremely high. It's 750. Cross the threshold at the age of 10, and that's why sometimes these are children who develop myocardial infarction around the age of 10. So these are concepts that I want you to be familiar with, and we're going to come back now to discussing inclisiran and see how they change. So here we take a theoretical person, a 30-year-old person with an average LDL of 100. And you remember seeing that for a moment. And the treatment is to give a single injection, 300 milligrams a year, one injection a year. And to make it simple, you do it at the same time that they get their flu vaccination. Now, what's the effect? I told you before that a single injection once a year will produce a 40% reduction in the LDL. So to come back to the slide that you saw before, this is the average person who crosses the threshold at the age of 70. Now, if we take this patient, or take this person, he's not a patient yet, and begin to give them a single injection once a year, beginning at the age of 30. So you can see the blue line begins at 30. The LDL drops from 100 to 60. And lo and behold, the threshold is not achieved until the age of 100. So by changing the cumulative LDL burden, you delay the expression and you delay the threshold. So this would be a way of delaying ischemic heart disease, coronary artery disease, until the age of 100. Now you can play games with that. you can say, well, why start at 30? What if you started at 50? Well, you would have a reduction, but it wouldn't be a 30-year reduction. You might prolong life by about 10 years until they develop the threshold. On the other hand, if you began this treatment not at the age of 30, but at the age of 20, you might never develop ischemic heart disease because you wouldn't reach the threshold until the age of 120. So I think that is a very important way of managing lipids, single injection once a year. And the final point I want to make is pretty far out at the present time. There is a way of getting rid of the gene, not suppressing the protein. That's what the inclisiran does. But, you know, with gene therapy, you get rid of the gene. And I think you've heard of CRISPR-based editing, recent Nobel Prize for gene therapy. And in this particular study, this was published in Nature about 2 months ago, it was a study on cynomolgus monkeys who got a single injection of an edited gene. So this was gene therapy, and it reduced the PCSK9 and reduced the LDL cholesterol by 60%. So if that were done in a child, the clinical studies with this gene therapy are about to start sometime during the next year. But I think the information on primates looks very encouraging, and that means a single treatment can abolish the possibility of coronary artery disease. So what we've done is we've gone a long way from beginning with statins and monoclonal antibodies to PCSK9, very important, but require injections frequently. Then we have inclisiran, annual injections. That's here now. That's possible right now. The drugs are very well tolerated. And where are we going in the future? In the future, we're going to gene therapy, which may need only a single treatment. Artificial intelligence, machine learning, very important. So investigators at the Mayo Clinic have played a very leadership role about artificial intelligence. And where they began was to look at a simple 12-lead ECG in patients who had a history of AF, but they were in sinus rhythm. The artificial intelligence was able to pick up changes in atrial depolarization that showed that there was a very good chance that they had had an experience with atrial fib, which of course means that they are likely to get it again. So the take-home message from that study was that an artificial intelligence-enabled ECG acquired during normal sinus rhythm, and that's the key point, it's during sinus rhythm, allowed the identification of individuals who have had a history of AF, even though they may not even have known it. So that's a very, very useful thing. And of course, it is a complicated machine, but it's a very, very simple thing to do once you hook the patient up. It's also possible with an electrocardiogram to determine whether patients are at risk of developing future ventricular dysfunction. So now you have the means from an ordinary 12-lead ECG to determine whether this is a patient who is likely to have recurrent AF and is or is not likely to develop ventricular dysfunction. So for, as a screening test, this is going to be extraordinarily important. You could also use artificial intelligence for predicting the mortality of patients with acute heart failure. This is a study that came from South Korea. And here are the examples of curves that show the likelihood of accurately detecting high-risk mortality. And the deep learning curve done by the machine is shown off on the left at the top, and that has a an area under the curve that's very high, 0.88. And all the other ones, techniques that have been around, risk scores that we use to assess risk of patients getting into of not surviving acute heart failure. So again, we have a relatively simple mechanical way of judging who is at the highest risk. And obviously, patients who are at that highest risk require very detailed attention. They may require left ventricular assist devices, et cetera. Inflammation, very important component of heart disease. And a lot of progress is being made in with anti-inflammatory drugs. And I would just like to review that very rapidly with you. So this is a schema of inflammation. It starts at the top with something that's called the inflammasome, which is the molecular basis of inflammation. And then you have these yellow pentagons of various components. And you see that on the right-hand side, you see that there are two drugs, colchicine and canakinumab. And the next slide, there's a one, and you can see that that one hits something called interleukin 1 beta, which is on the scheme of producing inflammation. And this is a study that was done by Paul Ritka, who is a colleague of mine at the Brigham and Women's Hospital. And it's a very important study, number one, canakinumab. It is a monoclonal antibody which doesn't affect anything except this interleukin. And it reduced the incidence of coronary artery disease. It reduced it significantly, but not enough to make this a useful clinical drug. Above that, you see colchicine, a drug that, of course, is well known to all of us. And colchicine has now been, it's an anti-inflammatory that acts at a higher level. And it's been shown to prolong life in patients with acute myocardial infarction and also in patients with chronic coronary artery disease. At the bottom left three is methotrexate. I think many of you are familiar with methotrexate. It is an anti-rheumatic drug. It's used in rheumatoid arthritis. And it had no benefit in contrast to canakinumab and colchicine. So it's not every anti-inflammatory. They have to work on this scheme, and the methotrexate doesn't work on that, so it is an anti-inflammatory, but it does not reduce the C-reactive protein. Above that, you see in red a new drug, sitelalimab, and that is a drug that's a monoclonal antibody that acts on interleukin 6. So here is a phase 2 trial, also by Paul Ritka. And these are patients who had coronary disease, who had a high C-reactive protein, and they were at high risk because they also had severe renal dysfunction. And you see the effects on the changes in the high sensitivity CRP. You see placebo on the left, no change. And then it's a dose effect curve. You can see that there was a marked reduction in C-reactive protein. In other words, a marked reduction in inflammation with 7.5 milligrams. And it gets a little better as the dose was increased to 30 milligrams. So this is a phase 2 trial. And this now is undergoing phase 3 trial. And I would be hopeful that because it has reduced inflammation to such an enormous extent, as you can see on the right portion of this slide, that this drug is likely to be very useful in slowing down ischemic heart disease. And the very last thing I want to talk to you about is CHIP, clonal hematopoiesis of independent potential. That's a mouthful. CHIP is much easier. And the next slide will show you what this is. So clonal hematopoiesis is a risk factor for atherosclerosis. This goes back about 5 years, group at Stanford. And they showed that the presence of CHIP in peripheral blood cells was associated with nearly a doubling in the risk of coronary heart disease in patients. It was also shown it accelerated atherosclerosis in mice, so it has worked both in mice and men. And so the clonal hematopoiesis is there's a stem cell in the bone marrow. There's an expansion of that, and it enters the bloodstream. And in the bloodstream, you can see that these are somatically mutated cells in the peripheral blood. And at the bottom, you see that they accelerate atherosclerosis, they accelerate thrombosis, they accelerate heart failure. And in patients who had this clonal hematopoiesis, this is a newly recognized risk factor, a 40% increase in cardiovascular disease, seen primarily in older people and somewhat more frequent in females. Fortunately, it does not cause leukemia or causes hematologic changes rarely, not never, but the major problem is cardiovascular. And what are the consequences of CHIP, of clonal hematopoiesis? Well, it produces progression of heart failure with reduced left ventricular ejection fraction and accelerated progression. So it is a serious risk marker. And in a paper that was just published about 2 months ago, this was expanded to women with premature menopause. So they developed clonal hematopoiesis. So premature menopause, this is the take-home message, is independently associated with CHIP among postmenopausal women. And the natural premature menopause could be a risk signal for predilection to develop CHIP and CHIP-associated cardiovascular disease. So we're seeing people who haven't developed CHIP but are at high risk of doing so. So I'm coming to the end of the grand rounds, and I've tried to give you a bird's eye view of where I think cardiology is going to go during the next 10 years. And I think the role of the cardiologist is changing. So, you know, in 2022, the job of the cardiologist primarily is to recognize and to manage established disease. You know, that's why we talk about precision medicine, get the right patient with the right treatment at the right time. I think 10 years from now, the principal role of the cardiologist, when all of the things that we discussed come into fruition, will be to interpret and apply genetic information and artificial intelligence in prevention, diagnosis, and treatment. So the cardiologist of the future is certainly going to need to be trained in the cardiology of today. The cardiology of today is not going away. But in addition to being trained in the cardiology of today, which I would call precision medicine, precision cardiology, the application of clinical care is going to be focused in one of three areas. Either the cardiologist will have to be knowledgeable in genetics and genomics. We saw examples of that. Population science and big data is certainly an area which cardiologists are going to have to become acquainted with. And the third one is artificial intelligence and machine learning. And all of those are going to be enormous challenges, but I think that they are probably going to change the picture of our specialty. Thank you very much for your attention, and thank you for allowing me to give this important lecture.
Dr. Braunwald, thank you so much for this vision. It really is very inspiring and causes a lot of stimulation actually here among all of us of where the vision of cardiology will be going. And thank you for sharing your thoughts and your wisdom and your amazing experience, clinical in addition to research over the years. I'll start, we have many questions, obviously we will won't be addressing all of them, but I will start with one question for you. You mentioned the polygenic risk score. You mentioned also the importance of interaction of clinical findings in such a patient. The question to you is, with the availability of more and more sophisticated imaging, biomarkers, genetic markers, and the clinical findings, do you see down the line us integrating these in a total risk score for such a patient at various stages in their life?
Good question, and the answer is a resounding yes. I think that the genetics by itself is okay for monogenic diseases. But I think that particularly in cardiology with chronic disease, there are many other factors besides the genetic. And I think you've mentioned them all. And we must not forget that we're doctors first and geneticists second. So we have to take advantage of the genomics, but that doesn't mean that we neglect the history, the clinical examination, and certainly the aids that come from modern imaging and biomarkers. So it's the total picture. I just want to be sure that genetics is not oversold or undersold. It takes its place along with these others.
Wonderful. I will read this amazing presentation by the greatest living legend of cardiology, Dr. Braunwald. An honor to listen to the new developments in cardiology. And I think two related questions that I see, which are very important, at least from your vision, your experience, and you seeing this field and cardiologists grow, is what advice do you have for medical students interested in cardiology as well as cardiology fellows? Basically, what advice do you have for the new generation that is growing in cardiovascular specialists?
Well, first of all, congratulations. You're choosing the most important specialty of medicine, but you better not tell that to my surgical friends. Anyway, I think that I think cardiology is changing, and we have to be alert to the changes. And so I mentioned that we now practice precision. We want to get the right treatment to the right patient at the right time in the right place. Okay, that's, but I think that things are moving along, and there has to be a greater focus on prevention. And I think an example would be that we have to begin to look at patients earlier. Now, a theme that runs through most of the six subjects that we've talked about is a more accurate determination of risk. And that's where a lot of things come into play. Well, why do we want to know the risk? Because we want to prevent the disease. I think there's going to be a greater interest in children. Because if we wait too long, we don't want to wait till the patient is 65 years old and has a myocardial infarction. We want to catch that when the patient is not a patient, but is 6 days old and knows, and we know that that patient is at risk. So I think bringing that into the picture is very important. I think we have to keep our eyes and ears open. You know, we're going through an incredible period now with the SGLT2 inhibitors, treatments for heart failure. Who would have thought 10 years ago that what were second tier drugs for diabetes would become first tier drugs for heart failure? So there are going to be surprises like that, and we have to be alert to that. And so it's an exciting field, and there's a long way to go.
Wonderful. I will end with two questions, and I will combine them because this is quite futuristic, although we've seen maybe the start of it just this past week. Is one, your thoughts on genetically modified xenotransplantation which just occurred? And
yes.
And two, your extended long-term wishes or vision, even beyond 10 years. That's what one individual asked. He said, "What would you what would you dream about?"
Well, yes. So I think the history of cardiac transplantation may be changing. I think that not having donors readily available, there's been a tremendous amount of work with heterozygous transplants, and I think we're now beginning to see the fruits of that. I think that obviously this has to be repeated, and before getting too excited, we want to be sure that it's peer-reviewed. But I think we're off to the races, and that can make a ginormous difference. And I think ultimately the dream is to prevent heart disease altogether. We have to work at both ends. With extreme heart failure, we have left ventricular assist devices, obviously. We have cardiac transplantation. Now maybe we will have heterozygous transplantation. But that's one end of the spectrum. The other end of the spectrum is not to let the patient get the disease in the first place.
Well, with that,
certainly that's what has happened with many infectious diseases. That doesn't mean all infections are gone, but there are certain infections like smallpox, malaria that are on the way out. Yep.
With that, I cannot thank you enough, and on behalf of all of us here and all the people that have been watching you today, thank you for the honor of sharing your time with us. Your lecture is inspirational, is visionary, and thank you for sharing your wisdom, your experience, your research, and for the vision of the future and everything that you do. Have a wonderful time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.